Before I start with the questions, I just summarize a little bit about the idea of the death contemplation, how it works. If you remember back, the very first thing I said was about just feel what it feels like to know that you're going to die. That even if you do that much, it's already a very useful thing. Because some people say, I feel ready, I've got nothing, no problems, I'm ready to go if necessary. Whereas other people feel a very strong sense that they're not ready for this. And if you're not ready, it means that there's something there which is kind of holding you back. Maybe something you regret, some unfinished business with some people, or whatever it is. So it's a very important opportunity to feel if there's anything in the world which isn't right. And straight away you know, okay, here I've got to do something. I've got to deal with these people, I've got to sort these things out. And remember, there's only one chance to sort things out, and that is now, in the present moment. So always take the opportunity straight away if things need to be sorted out. Because later may not actually arrive, and that's kind of the point of it. And the second thing, to make this meditation work, it's important to make it realistic. The more realistic you make it, the more powerful it's going to be. So you have to have, if you can, have the sense that actually, at the end of the meditation, you are really going to be dead. If that's kind of your perception is that when your meditation comes to an end, actually, that could be the end of everything. That could be your real death. If you're ready to die at the end of the meditation, and then the process will be much more realistic, and it won't just be a kind of a pure fantasy, but actually a readiness for the whole process. These are just a couple of hints to make it work, do it gently, do it in a way that you know you feel you can deal with it. Some people find it easy, some people find it difficult, but I think it's really worthwhile for everyone. Okay, let us move on to the questions. So these are the remnants from yesterday. So let's see what is here. Okay, dear Ajahn Brahmani, I tend to spend time on reflection, hopefully wise reflection, as I learn from mistakes in the past and try not to repeat them. But does this distract from meditation? In meditation, one tries to avoid thinking. Is that correct? Please explain. Thank you. So what I would recommend you to do is to decide before you do the meditation what kind of meditation you want to do. So you have a kind of a clarity of purpose. If you just allow anything to happen, then it's not going to be very structured and nothing is really going to happen as a consequence. So decide at the beginning what you're going to do. Okay, now I'm going to try to watch the breath. I'm going to do metta. I'm going to just kind of see what's happening. I'm just going to sit back and just relax and see what comes up in the mind. All of these things are valid ways of doing the meditation practice. Or you can, if you wish, if you just want to allow the mind to wander and to kind of think a bit about the sutta or reflect about whatever, you can do that as well. Usually a bit of structure is often important. When you go outside and you do a bit of walking meditation, then often it's easier to just allow the mind to wander and see what happens in the mind. And you get to know yourself quite clearly. What are your problems? What are the things that are hindering your progress? And you see that simply by watching the content of your own mind, things arising, things passing away. So try to be a little bit structured. If you make it too unstructured, but allow everything to be and just kind of think everything is okay, then a bit of direction is always useful. And just decide that in the beginning, and very often when you decide it in the beginning, it's as if the mind already knows what to do in a sense. You don't have to tell it that much more afterwards. It kind of moves towards peace, it moves towards the breath automatically. So hopefully that helps us to see if that works for you now. Okay. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, thank you very much for the insightful teaching. Please come to England again soon. Okay. Okay, we shall see what happens. These things are always uncertain and unreliable. With after the death contemplation, you should take nothing for granted. Okay. Okay, dear Ajahn Brahmani, this morning I had a very nice and peaceful meditation. Well done, that's always wonderful to hear now. I felt very passive and still. Coming out of it, I felt happy and good. I went out to stretch my legs and suddenly I was overcome by fear. how can one who becomes a passive live in this world? Okay. As the fear and emotions got intense, I lay down on the grass, and when I opened my eyes, I saw a lot of tiny, shiny particles that added to my fear. Was I going mad? The shiny thing disappeared when I closed my eyes and reappeared again when I opened them. Gradually, they and the fear disappeared throughout the day. I know that strange things can happen during an after meditation, but please can you reassure me that I'm not going crazy? How do we overcome fear on the path? Thank you. P.S. Many thanks to the kind people sharing chocolate, etc. in the afternoon. Okay, that's wonderful. So the thing about meditation practice, you know, I don't know exactly why you were fearful. If you had a nice meditation that came out afterwards, maybe you were afraid of it disappearing, maybe there was a little bit of holding on, maybe you realize you can't keep these things in your daily life, and maybe the fear came from that. Yeah, not that there was anything bad in the meditation as such, but how you dealt with it, how you looked at it afterwards, that could be the reason. I don't know, you have to obviously investigate these things for yourself. It's just a suggestion, really. So what I would suggest you do, just, you know, do it again and next time. Every time you do this, every time you become peaceful and you enjoy your meditation practice, you will become more and more reassured that you can always go back there when you need to, because you understand that there is a path into these things. And if you live your life well, you do the right thing, that path is always accessible by you if you need to go there. That gives you a sense of reassurance, and then the fear will subside as a consequence. Yeah, so that is, I think, the best way to deal with that. Whether you are going mad or not, well, really, the fear is there, but usually, if your mind otherwise is fairly stable, yeah, you have a certain degree of clarity about what's going on, things are not kind of going terribly, you're not feeling very deluded or anything like that, there's just a little bit of fear arising, there shouldn't be a problem. If there is a lot of fear, and you start to fear it sounds a bit dangerous or whatever, you come and talk to me, have a chat with me. I'm always happy to be available to have a chat with anyone which feels a bit unbalanced or whatever. And so please do so. Don't kind of go so far that you kind of feel kind of out of your depth and things are going wrong. You're always welcome to come and see me if something starts to feel a bit funny. Sometimes just talking to somebody can balance you back again, bring you back to reality, and you understand that there's nothing here to be afraid of there. So you're quite right. Be careful. Don't kind of allow things to go too far. There comes a point when it's time to relax and take it easy. Another time when it's the right time to apply oneself. So always kind of come back to your mind state. What is your mind state like? So to me, it doesn't sound like this is very dangerous at all, because we had a good meditation beforehand. There should be nothing problematic there. If you had a terrible meditation beforehand, and then you started to see strange things, then it is kind of perhaps a little bit more grounds for concern. But I think in this case, it should be perfectly all right. But remember, there are people who don't enjoy meditation, find meditation very hard, and it's perfectly okay if someone here is one of those people, you find that meditation practice is very difficult. I think we had one person who left the retreat already because just the noble silence was too difficult. It's okay. Yeah, it's not as if you can't meditate, you are a failure. Not at all. That is not the essence of the Buddhist path. The essence is kindness. Meditation is a support for that. So if you don't enjoy meditation, don't do it, or do less of it, or do it in a different way, or whatever. Don't force yourself to do these things if you find it very difficult and hard. Okay. Dear Ajahn, the Buddha appears to provide a lot of solution to those that are suffering, e.g. depressed, anxious, etc. Modern society and medicine offer solutions through medication, such as antidepressants. What is your view on modern mental health treatments? How can they be made compatible with the teachings of the Buddha? Thank you. So modern mental health treatments are useful, as long as they work, as long as they kind of do something for people, they can be used. Sometimes when people get very serious mental problems, whether it's psychosis or schizophrenia or depression or whatever it is, sometimes you have to use medication to balance yourself out. If you're not on medication, if you have schizophrenia, if you're not on medication, it can be had terrible consequences. It can be far, far worse. So medication is sometimes required. And then using medication in the right way to get the balance in the mind again, then you can use meditation, use the Buddhist path to actually use that in conjunction with medication. Yeah. So I think using medication is perfectly fine. In fact, in many cases, it's far preferable to use medication than just to kind of carry on and not get anywhere and everything being quite terrible. But if you have had some trauma in your life, and many people have, it's also fine to go and see a psychologist or a psychiatrist to get some help. Yeah. Because sometimes these are professionals that know how to deal with traumatic situations, difficult things. This is not what the Buddhist teaching specializes in. If you had some abuse as a child or whatever, or something like that, then go and see a psychiatrist. They're there to help you. Yeah, nothing to be embarrassed about if you have to see someone to help you. It's a positive thing, so you can get out of that situation, and then you can get on with your practice and the path and all these other things. It's important that we destigmatize the idea of seeking help for these problems, because very often, if we stigmatize that, then it makes it difficult for people to actually resolve issues that need to be resolved. So please support people if they need this kind of support by others. The Buddhist path has its place, these other things also have their place, and together they can often work very well in conjunction. Okay. Dear Ajahn, where do you watch the breath? Okay, it's a very simple question. Only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 words. And where you watch it, you can watch it wherever you like. It doesn't really matter so much. What the Anapanasati Sutta says, and we'll see that hopefully starting on that tomorrow perhaps. Today is Friday, right? So we have Saturday and then Sunday morning. Only 3 more sessions with suttas. Too fast, isn't it? So when we have a look at that, we'll talk about these issues. But basically, the breath does not say that it has to be watched anywhere in particular. The Pali word that is used to explain this in the Anapanasati Sutta is parimokkhang. And a lot has been written about what parimokkhang actually means. But mukha is the mouth or the face. Pali usually means around. So it means something like in the kind of immediate presence of the person. Something like that is what it means. That is what certain scholars have decided is the contextual meaning of this particular word. So don't worry so much about where you watch the breath. All you have to do is to know whether the breath is going in or the breath is going out. Exactly where you know that, how you know that, is completely irrelevant. But you can, breath going in, breath going out. Yeah, it doesn't matter how you know that, but you know it's going in and you know it's going out. And that is all you have to do. And this is the way I have been taught by Ajahn Brahm. Yeah. It always just kind of focuses on nothing in particular. And that gives you a kind of a slightly expansive way of looking at the breath. If you try to focus too hard on a particular point of the body, like the tip of the nose or the upper lip or something like that, which is the traditional way of doing things. The reason why it is traditional, because this is how it is explained in the commentaries. And most people take the commentaries to be kind of, this is what you have to do. But the commentaries are not the final word on this thing. They're just one opinion among many opinions. So I tend to follow Ajahn Brahm's techniques, because I know Ajahn Brahm very well. I trust his technique. So I follow the way he does things. But he just says, just know it's going in, know it's going out. Forget about it. It's not body contemplation, it's breath contemplation. So forget about the body. Yeah. And then I think it gives you a bit more room for it's not so narrow focus, and there's less chance you will get the headaches that some people get. Somebody mentioned that to you today, that they sometimes get the samadhi headache. Yeah, it's actually not samadhi headache, it's actually non-samadhi headache. But anyway, you know. So this is an important. So that's what I would do. So try that out and see if that works for you now. Dear Ajahn Ramali, you're doing a great job of selling the monastic life. However, I'm not sure if everyone is going to ordain straight after the retreat. Really? Wow, what a disappointment. I thought everyone would want it. That being said, I wonder if you could talk a little about the teachings the Buddha gave to lay people that deal directly with lay life, challenges and opportunities. Thanks. The teachings that Buddha gave to lay people. Now, the Buddha, the usual teachings the Buddha gives to lay people, basically it is the same stuff. Yeah, whether you are a lay person or a monastic, the teachings are the same. There isn't really any difference. The difference is that sometimes to monastics he gives more deep teachings, to lay people he gives sometimes not quite as deep teachings. But it really depends on the context. So really everyone gets the same kind of teachings. Remember one of the things that Buddha says in the Mahaparinibbana Sutta? He has no teacher's fist. Yeah, Acharya Muti. And the idea with that is that you have nothing that you hold back. Yeah, teacher is like holding back certain teachings that are only for either to be spoken at the very end of your life, or they are specialized for an inner circle of disciples, but not for everyone else. Buddhism isn't like that. There isn't kind of an inner circle like the real teachings, and the outer ones, they only get to hear kind of the simple stuff. Yeah, it's very good it isn't like that, because this is the classic way that you create a cult. You create a cult by withholding the teachings. Only when you get close to the teacher kind of you get told the deeper things, and everyone else, they're on the outside. And of course, that creates this atmosphere of a certain privileged people and everyone else trying to get into that privileged circle. Classic cultish way of creating cults. And that's why it is so dodgy. And this is why it is so wonderful that the Buddha did not teach like that. Everything is out in the open. So this is the first thing to realize. All the teachings are really there for everyone. But there is a book that you could buy if you're interested in it. And this is specifically a book on the teachings to lay people by the Buddha, by a fellow called John Kelly, who I actually happen to know. It's very, very nice fellow. He's Australian, by the way. And he worked also closely with Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi when he translated the numerical discourses, and he published a book on the lay teachings specifically. So you may find that interesting. Look up John Kelly online, and I think the book is sold by Wisdom Publications. Other books come from there. But very often when the Buddha teaches lay people, he says things like, you know, be virtuous, yeah, be generous, yeah, simple teachings. Sometimes he tells the lay people, you should also go on retreat sometimes and practice meditation. Yeah, sometimes he says that. Sometimes you should withdraw. He says that to another Pindika, I think, in one place. You should withdraw and you should also enjoy that happiness that comes from seclusion, that comes from withdrawing from society. You are lay people, we should also enjoy that. And that usually refers to samadhi, yeah, and jhanas and that sort of stuff. So these are the teachings given to lay people. And sometimes when somebody is on the deathbed, yeah, then the Buddha or one of the monks or whatever will give a more profound teaching to someone who's about to die, because that's when people often are more ready to profound teachings, especially if they already had some samadhi beforehand. Is there anything else that should be said on this topic, special teachings to lay people? There aren't really, you know, it's all the same, you know, it's Dhamma is Dhamma. There's nothing that is special for anyone. If you are a person and you feel the world, then the teachings are for you. That's what the Buddha says about it. If you feel the world, if you feel, then if you don't feel, then you are probably a zombie, so you probably don't really need to be in this on this retreat. Yeah, for this is not for zombies, it's only for proper human beings. So zombies are the only ones that kind of don't count. Otherwise, if you're a lay person, monastic, male, female, gay, straight, whatever, it doesn't matter. Yeah, these things are for you now. Okay. Dear Anjan, thank you for articulating the teaching so beautifully. How should one approach reasonably continuous mind-produced physical discomfort, pain that is strong enough to dominate attention? Mind-produced physical pain. Okay, not entirely sure what you mean by that. Do you mean like you are kind of trying too hard in a meditation to get a headache? Is that what you mean? Or do you mean, I'm not entirely clear, what do you mean by mind-produced physical discomfort? Usually physical discomfort is kind of in the body. If it is mind-produced, then I suppose you have to deal with the mind somehow and kind of make the mind relax and make the mind stop producing the pain, I suppose. Well, that's what you have to do. It's very hard to kind of give any advice without really understanding exactly what you are talking about here. I never kind of come across this idea before that the physical discomfort is mind-produced. But I think regardless of whether it's mind-produced or from the body, and it dominates attention, basically always the idea is to try to find the posture where the pain is minimal. That's usually the first thing here. And whatever that posture is, it is acceptable for you. So if you want to lie down, you can lie down. But I know a number of people who have successful meditation by lying down. If you lie down, lie in a posture that is different from the one you normally use to sleep in. So if you sleep on your side, what many people do, lie on your back. Yeah, and then see if that works for you. Or you can start in a sitting posture, and when the pain gets bad, you can change to lying down afterwards to help you give rise to mindfulness while sitting, and then lying down when your mindfulness is properly established. Otherwise, what you have to do is you have to try to kind of extract yourself a little bit from that physical discomfort and pain. Try to get some distance from it. And this is what mindfulness is all about. Trying to see it as an object rather than be involved in it. This is not so easy to do. This takes a lot of training. And that's why I always say, don't sit with pain. But if you haven't got any choice, then maybe that's what you have to try to do from the very beginning. Pull back. See the pain as an object. And when you see the pain as an object, you don't get involved with it anymore. Then it doesn't matter so much. You can kind of receive for what it is, and your mind is still fairly peaceful. And then you can go back to your meditation as a consequence. Go out walking. Do these things as well if that helps for your pain. Again, I'm not entirely sure what you mean by what you said there. So maybe there are other things that can be done if I understood a bit more what you were referring to. Anyway, last question from yesterday here. Dear Ajahn, I was thinking about your disagreement with Bhikkhusudatta, retranslation of samadhi as immersion rather than stillness, and was wondering whether it was because he's been conditioned as an Australian to have affinity with the sea. Immersion in deep, calm blue sea is the imagery that comes to mind. Would this be a suitable analogy for samadhi? That is kind of the point, yeah? You are immersed in something, that's kind of the issue. You're completely immersed inside of yourself and you lose access to the external world in the same way that you are immersed in the ocean. So yes, that is kind of the point of that. I'm Norwegian and everyone here is British. We're pretty close to the sea as well, So immersion should kind of work with us as well. I've kind of grown up with the ocean around me and all these kind of things. But still, I don't really kind of, it doesn't quite work with me, I feel that. But yes, I mean, I think the point is that translations is often very personal. Some people might like immersion, Some people might like stillness, some people might even like concentration. All that has been banned by Ajahn Brahm. So I have to be very careful what I say, otherwise I might get a kind of, something might happen, I'm not sure what. So it's always, we relate differently to vocabulary and words and so many things. So if you find immersion works for you, great, that is good. For me, I don't feel it has a very kind of emotional, doesn't work for me so much. Maybe, what is that Norwegian word for immersion? I wonder, immersion in Norwegian. My Norwegian vocabulary is really going down. I can't really talk Norwegian anymore, so it's very difficult. So, immersion. Okay, whatever. We'll leave that for another time. Okay, let's move on. Oh, actually, we should definitely move on because there are so many questions here. Whoa! Okay. It's actually wonderful. I'm very glad to see so many questions because people are interested. It's always great. Here, Ajahn Bamali, if the mind has negative emotions like fear and doubt and thoughts, and we push them aside and try to develop more positive thoughts and emotions, which are more conducive to meditation. What happens to that negativity if it is only ignored? Do we end up with a storm of it that is affecting us deep down? Thank you. Okay, that's a good, very good question. And the point here, the point is not to kind of push them aside or to suppress them or repress them or anything like that. That is not the point of this. The point of this is actually to overcome them completely so they are gone. You actually see the world in a different way. Now, why is it that sometimes you feel negative about things? Why is it that you get angry? Why is that sometimes you feel friendly? And the reason is because the conditioning at each stage is different. The reason why you're angry is very specific. It's because you're focusing on the negative qualities of somebody. The reason why you have friendliness or metta towards someone is because you're focusing on the good qualities. So once you understand that conditionality, and you understand how these things work, you use that to your advantage, and you focus on the good qualities rather than the bad qualities. But it has to be done in an easy, relaxed, and natural way, not by suppression, by forcing down the negative thoughts. If that is what you do, it's going to end up being bad for you. Yeah, it's not by suppressing, but by actually, by really changing things up. Really say, wait a minute, why am I looking at the negative qualities? There are so many good ones to look at here. Okay, let's look at those instead. Yeah? If the negative emotion towards someone is very strongly established, then this is not going to work. Then often you have to wait for the emotion to disappear gradually. And you can't just substitute in this way, because when defilements are deeply entrenched in the mind, they're hard to overcome. And the Buddha says as much in the suttas. So make it natural. Don't use force. Yeah? Make it real. You actually really overcome these things. Just as in daily life, you have a positive attitude. You make that positive attitude happening by understanding the conditionality behind it, how it comes about, the causality. So don't store all this negative energy. The whole point is to get rid of it completely so it doesn't come back. It's not stored anywhere. It is just abandoned altogether. And gradually you become a more positive person in an honest, real, authentic way, not in some kind of suppressed individual. It's terrible to be a repressed, suppressed individual. It makes it just worse. That's not what we want to be on the Buddhist path. We want to be authentically happy here, authentically kind, not in some kind of, pretend way or whatever. Okay. Yeah, I cannot express enough how inspiring it has been to listen to you illuminate the suttas this week. I will definitely be investigating the Nikayas when I return home. Mission accomplished. Okay, great. I'm very glad to hear that. Good, that is very, very nice of you to say that. As we prepare to recommence our normal lives, i.e. non-retreat, exactly. I'm glad you said that, because what actually is a normal life and what is not is really kind of subject to, we could question that, yeah? So that's a good point. On Monday morning, please share with us some advice on how to prepare ourselves for the return to the daily routine. With metta and thanks. Okay, let me put that one to one side for now, and I talk about that tomorrow instead, because not tomorrow, maybe even on Sunday instead, when we kind of come to the very end. So we don't focus too much on the end. It's a bit sad to talk about the end, isn't it? Let's talk about the end when it actually is there, rather beforehand. But thank you for that question. It's a good one. Venerable Sir, thank you very much for relieving me of a foreboding I have carried with me for many decades, that irrespective of the good karma I have accumulated in my lifetime, my last thought moment at that time of death, if unwholesome, would condemn me to an inferior rebirth. I can now face my death with less trepidation. Much better. Okay, I'm very glad to hear that. Because this is precisely the sort of thing that happens. Yeah, if you think that your last thought moment is going to be what determines your rebirth, then regardless of what you've done in your life, it's kind of terrible, isn't it? And it kind of is scary, and it makes... So it's a very good point. So it's good to sometimes, the thing is that in popular Buddhism, sometimes we don't know what the Buddha said and what kind of is just part of the popular Buddhist culture, simply because we haven't studied the suttas enough. Okay. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, I have a dream that someday women and men will be equal and that they will not be divided just because of their gender. Do you think it's utopia? That someday when people will go forth and enjoy the monastic life in the BSAA, that they will not be divided as nuns and monks, but that they can join the monastic life together, maybe as nunks. Or maybe Indeed, they can start as lands of monks, and after a while they can be upgraded to monks later on, okay? I know it's probably a waste of time to have dreams like this, but it's just one of the things that often appear in my mind and meditation. Thanks for a lovely retreat with Metta. Yes, I cannot foretell the future, so I really don't know what's going to happen. Maybe we'll have monks in the future. It's hard to say. But the problem with that is that, because the Buddha established a Bhikkhuni Sangha and the Bhikkhu Sangha from the beginning, it is very unlikely that anyone will really be able to override that completely and have everyone just live together. We have to assume that the Buddha had a reason for dividing the Sangha in this way. And if you trust the Buddha, you tend to then kind of go without advice. But of course, exactly how far you have to live apart is another thing. In Perth, there's a long distance between the two monasteries, over an hour to drive from the monk's monastery to the nun's monastery. There's a lot of separation. Whether you really have to be that separated is a different question. And it may very well be, and there are monasteries being established in Australia now. One of them is the Newbury Buddhist Monastery. And in that, they have one large property, 150 acres. And they probably will have kind of two separate zones, if you like, on that large property. And then they will have like a meditation hall in common and that sort of thing. So that is an alternative way of doing things. There is separation, but not that much. So there's more opportunity to consult with each other or whatever else is required. So the future is uncertain, yeah? Keep your ears open, and one of these days, maybe your coinage of monks will somehow appear on the internet somewhere, and you see what happens, basically. Okay. Dear Bhante, the similes on sensual pleasure are so powerful, yet as lay people, I think we all realize to what extent each of us is bound up with sensuality. It seems remaining aloof from the pull of them that society impinges on us may be the only way to stay afloat in the current. How can we ensure we keep strong in the absence of an established local sangha? I know no local Buddhist, and most family and friends are totally into materialism. Thank you, Vimetta. The purpose of these similes is just to kind of guide your mind in the right direction, to get some sense that there is a problem here, yeah? So, and this is really the point, that every time you hear about similes like this, and there are others too in the suttas, it will make an impact on you, huh? And the more ready you are to hear about these things, in other words, the longer you have lived with kindness in your life, your meditation is getting better, all of these kind of things, the more impact these teachings will have on you, because you start to understand what is going on, and your mind will be receptive for these things. So just allow these things to develop. Don't try to go too much against the stream of the world, because if you try that too hard, you're going to end up suffering a lot in lay life. Yeah, it's okay. You enjoy yourself within the bounds of the five precepts. You enjoy yourself within the bounds of what is reasonable. Yeah, you live life like that. Otherwise, it becomes too hard to exist in the world. And then, if you feel that you are inclining towards monastic life at some point, then you can kind of think about monastic life instead. So that is what I would do. I know that there are some lay people who live on the eight precepts all the time. And if you can do that and you want to do that, it's wonderful. Yeah, it's great. But make sure if you do that, that it comes quite naturally to you. You don't have to force yourself too much. You don't have to kind of grit your teeth and press the tongue against the roof of your mouth and say, oh, yeah, because then life becomes too unpleasant. And when it becomes too unpleasant, after a while, you're going to get fed up. And then and when you get fed up, it's all going to go downhill from there. And that's much worse. So be careful. Take things gradually. Allow things to come naturally to you. Read the suttas. Continuously condition yourself in the right way. And as you do that, the gradual renunciation will come all by itself. But it will be gradual. It will take time. And then you will be on the right track. Something like that. Yeah. And there isn't any final recipe for these things, but that's some ideas anyway for you now. Dear Ajahn, during the breath meditation, when your focus moves from the breath to watch the mind, do you become completely unaware of the breath? Or does the breath come to you from time to time as you watch the mind? The idea here is that when we do the breath meditation, the breath is usually there to some extent. Yeah? So as the breath gets more profound, as the meditation gets deeper and deeper, the breath is often there in the background, regardless, or in the foreground, depending on how you focus on things. So even when the kind of the positive feelings start to arise in the mind, you stay with the breath, because the breath is the cause often that allows the positive feelings to come. Then as the mind goes even deeper and you start to see things like nimittas, bright lights and things, that is the point where you're just staying with the mind. The breath is still there sometimes, very, very subtly, yeah, in the background. Your focus is now moving mostly towards the nimittas, but the breath is still present. And that's why it is still breath meditation at this point. So use the breath as your anchor point. Yeah, and then that is because that is a thing which allows you to move through this process. I will talk more about this when we get to the Anapanasati Sutta. Again, start maybe tomorrow or Sunday morning, we'll see what happens with that. Dear Ajahn, you previously stressed the importance of a sequence in the Buddha's teachings. In the five hindrances sequence, sensual desire comes before ill will. Yet you have suggested that tackling ill will is the most important thing to do. Intuitively, this advice feels right to me, but I wonder if you could please briefly explain why a sequence isn't so significant here. Also, please reconsider your stance on human rights. Everyone should be entitled to delicious silence. Yes, that's good. Bang, thanks to all who have helped to create it here, particularly Prachanda, and organizing and supporting him. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. That's very good. About the five hindrances, the reason for the sequence, I think, has more to do with the importance of the hindrances. Yeah. So it is not necessarily that it just means that you should, the sequence in which you should tackle them is not, that's not necessarily what it is about. It has many reasons for why you have a particular sequence. And I think the sequence has more to do with the importance of each of the hindrances. The most profound, the most deep-rooted, and the most pervasive of the five hindrances is sensual desire. And that is the hindrance which ultimately gives rise to all the other ones, to a very large extent. Ill will comes from sensuality not being gratified, or from getting sensual discomfort rather than sensual comfort. Yeah, then ill will arises. People do bad things, you get angry as a consequence. The other three hindrances are very similar. They come in large part because of sensual desire and ill will. The three other ones arise. So I think there it is more a sense of kind of importance. What is in the final analysis, what is the hindrance which support all the other ones, and the one that has to be removed ultimately for everything else to fall into place. I think that is what is happening here. But in terms of focusing on removal, I think the number one should be ill will. Okay, so good. Yeah, everyone should be entitled to the delicious silence. I really agree with that one. I think that should be part of the human rights. I think that is actually a very, very good idea. And that's very, very good. Great. Okay. So thank you for that. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Two incredibly moving and inspiring talks today about metta and the dangers of sensuality. Thank you for your teachings. Okay. It's wonderful, isn't it? No question. Just a happy, happy explanation. That's great. I'll put that down here in case we get a rainy day. The sun is still shining, but I'll keep it there and bring it out when. Sometimes. This is what Ajahn Brahm does. Sometimes he gets some nice letters and he puts it up on his little notice board in his office. Yeah, so they're sitting there. And sometimes he gets some very nice cards and things, which are really nice. So I think I'm going to start doing the same now. Dear Ajahn Brahmali, kindly explain ways to a positive outlook. Often one gets trapped into the negativity of the world. Thank you. Your insight is much appreciated, as is your explanation of the sutta. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Okay, so how do you explain the ways to a positive outlook? And there are many many ways, obviously, you can do this, but one of the great ways to have a positive outlook is to look at where you are now compared to where you were a while ago. If you have been practicing the Buddhist teachings for a while and you're starting to see the benefits of these teachings, look at who you are today compared to who you were a few years ago, a few months ago, or whatever. That's what I do when I want to kind of make myself happy, because I think, oh, meditation is good enough. But then I think, actually, when I compare myself now to what I was, you know, some years ago, wow, it's really heading in the right direction. So very often we have a tendency to fault find and look for what we still need to do in life, or what we still kind of haven't achieved yet. But instead of looking at that, look at what you already have done. And actually, it becomes often much more, much better. And you start to feel really good about yourself as a consequence of that. And the other thing, the other reason why people often get negative about the world is because they don't watch the news. Yeah, don't watch the news. That's what I recommend. It's rubbish, the news. It's terrible stuff. The tech, you know, it's a coming together of the absolutely worst stuff that happens anywhere around the globe, packed into 20 minutes. And all we get is the bad news around the globe. Yeah, it's a digest of the worst news possible in the whole world. This is not the reality. Nobody lives like that. Yeah, most days we walk around, we kind of meet our neighbors. Oh, good morning, neighbor. How are you today? Oh, yeah, it's okay. I hope you didn't watch the news. No, I watched the news today. So this is not our lived reality. Our lived reality is so different from the news. And because of that, it really is just drags us down kind of unnecessarily to watch the news. And somehow we feel compelled to watch the news. It becomes like an addiction. Yeah, it is actually hard to withdraw from it. You get kind of withdrawal symptoms or whatever. I try to tell my parents, they do listen to me sometimes, but when I suggest not to watch the news, there was no chance at all I could stop them doing that. Absolutely no chance. These are some ways. The other way, of course, is to hang around the right kind of people. Yeah, if you feel a bit down, just tune into Ajahn Brahm on a Friday night, and he will quickly kind of pick you back up again, and you'll feel really good afterwards. He will tell you a few jokes, he will kind of laugh a little bit. And this is kind of the purpose, in a sense, of Ajahn Brahm's Dhamma talks, in very large part, is to put you into a good mood, so that you are ready for meditation, ready to live your life well as a consequence of that. So this is the way. And if you look back on your life and you see how far you've come, suddenly the future starts to look incredibly bright. Because you know you're heading in the right direction. You know you have done so already. This is going to happen in the future. Boy, this is better. I'm really going somewhere very positive, very, very nice. It makes you feel very... your whole thing starts to change because you look at the world in a different way. So this is how to become positive. Doing metta as well is a way to become positive, because if you do metta practice, you are deliberately focusing on the good qualities of people in the world. Do a bit of metta meditation in your life. Just find a nice guided metta meditation if you can, because that can help you to kind of keep you going, at least until you get used to doing it on your own, and then you don't need the guidance anymore so much. Okay, so try some of those things and see what happens. Dear Ajahn, if someone has hurt me or upset me, I find it difficult to let go of my emotions straight away and focus on the positive qualities of that person. I feel as if I have dismissed my own emotions of getting hurt, as if it does not matter. Should I have met that to myself first, before seeing the positive qualities of the other person? Am I being selfish here? Then again, I don't want to be hypocritical. Also, how do you avoid reacting immediately when somebody gets angry at you and say something? Okay, that's a good question. And you have a point. You should not dismiss your own feelings and try to override them in that way. That is not really what this is about. Very often, what you have to do is to catch it as it is happening. So someone is hurting you, and straight away you realize they have the problem, not you. Yeah, at that moment, straight away, you realize this person has a problem, not me. They are the one who need compassion, because they are the ones who created suffering for themselves. I can deal with this or whatever. But if they have already hurt you and you didn't kind of catch it quickly enough, and then you feel a bit resentful because of that, which is quite natural, then you need to give yourself a bit of time to overcome that resentment before you start to focus on the good qualities in the other person. Again, we should not repress and suppress our own emotions, push them out of the way, not have metta for themselves. So in the beginning, yes, have a bit of compassion for yourself. Think, wow, this is the way the world is. This is the dukkha of the world. And just kind of allow yourself to feel the suffering. And don't be afraid of that. And as you feel the suffering, you also learn a little bit about suffering at the same time. You understand that this is the way the world has to be. Yeah, can't really escape these things. And as you do that, you learn something, and at the same time, you allow things to kind of disappear. And this is why I think one of the great ways of dealing with suffering in the life is just to feel it rather than to feel oppressed by it. Feel the suffering instead of trying to push it away. This is what it feels like. And if you just feel the suffering and you know the world has to be this way, you become less reactive. You become more accepting of what is going on. And you just you shrug your shoulders and you realize existence is like this. It's very helpful for a number of reasons. It makes you less angry. It makes you more understanding of what the world is like, and it gives you more insight into the situation because you don't react so much to it. Then when you calm down and you're able to accept, okay, I feel hurt by this, and you kind of get a bit of distance to yourself, then you readjust your mindset, and you focus on the positive qualities of the person, or you just have compassion for them because you know that it is they need compassion because they don't know what they're doing, basically. So yes, indeed, have metta for yourself first. In that sense, it is very useful. You're not being selfish at all, you're just being reasonable. So please be reasonable there. And how do you avoid reacting immediately when somebody gets angry at you and says something? Well, this is how you do it. You do it by having a very deeply considered this point that when other people are angry, they are the ones who have the problem. Yeah, it's not you. It's got nothing to do with when somebody else gets angry with you. It has nothing to do with you. It has to do with them. It has to do with their conditioning. You just happen to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. So you have to bear the brunt of their emotions. But actually, they are the ones who have the problem. Yeah, once you get that, the reason we get upset and angry is because we feel it's personal. They are hurting me. Yeah, that's the problem. But once you take the personality out of this, once you don't see it as they are hurting me, but it's their conditioning that's coming out of this person, then it's no longer an issue. It is no longer personal. It's just got to do with them. Then you can shrug your shoulders. You can say, okay, whatever, good luck, or whatever else that you do, because you realize that this is not a personal issue at all. It's just their conditioning coming out. So getting angry is never useful. And gradually, as you reflect on that, and you have to reflect on it quite a bit. This is what I mean by reflecting on the suttas and reflecting on the content of the suttas, is that you make these understandings as real as you possibly can. But when you do confront these kind of situations, you know what you have to do straight away. It happens automatically because you've trained yourself in this way. Okay, I hope that helps. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, thank you so much for this retreat. I have learned so much from you. Suttas I have read in the past have new life after your explanations. I think I may have found a clue to help solve Venerable Samvidhi's riddle. I found it written on a stone in the ground of the old chapel near this center. I can explain my idea after the retreat if you like. Okay, good. Great. If you feel that you have another explanation for what I have, then that's wonderful. And if it works for you, and if you have a chance and you see me, you can grab me by my robe and you can tell me after the retreat. Okay, so now I read the backside. Okay, too late now. It says here, okay, that's fine. I'm sure you're okay. So, good. So see what happens. And then we will take it as it comes. Dear Ajahn, a Tibetan monk once told me that from meditating too much, you could get sick. In particular, you could get all kinds of nervous problems. What is your view on this? How much meditation do you consider too much? Do as much meditation as you enjoy. Yeah, as long as you enjoy it, as long as you feel that you're making progress, as long as you are getting peaceful or whatever, it can't really be too much. Yeah, if you enjoy to sit for 10 hours in a stretch, then sit for 10 hours in a stretch. If you enjoy only 5 minutes, sit for 5 minutes. Sometimes, even if you don't enjoy it, try a little bit. And then if it doesn't work out, then get up and do something else. But it's all about enjoyment. As long as you enjoy it, it will improve your health, not make it decline. Yeah, because your mind gets better, your mind is in a better situation, your mind is in a better, it's good for the body, it's good for the mind, it's good for everything, and it will be very positive for you. So there's no such thing as too much, as long as you enjoy it. What is bad is if you meditate really hard, you're not getting anywhere, you're trying, you're pushing yourself, your mind is full of defilements, you get more and more angry, more and more deluded, that is when it's bad, and that's probably when you get sick in the end. Okay, dear Ajahn Mamali, it is a relief to hear you say not to put too much emphasis on the last thought before dying. Okay, how should one prepare oneself for eventual death? Much merited. So, the answer to that question is the best way to prepare yourself for your death is what you're doing now. Yeah, you're coming on a retreat, you're meditating, you're being kind to others, you're being generous. You're listening to the teachings of the Buddha, all this kind of thing. This is the best thing you can do. Do as much of this as you possibly can. Just practice the path. Learn also the Buddha's teachings. And the reason why it is so useful to learn it is because you will recognize them in your next life, quite likely. The more you go directly to the source, the word of the Buddha, the more likely you are to recognize Buddhism in your next life. If you just listen to idiosyncratic teachings from various teachers, those are not going to be around in your next life because they just come and go like fly-by-night teachings, whatever they call them. Whereas the teachings of the Buddha, they're always going to be there because these are the things that are being repeated and being looked after and kept over long periods of time. That is why you want to focus, another reason why you want to focus on the teachings of the Buddha. So keep on doing all of these things. And then when you die, you will be in the best possible position to die well. When you die, I would recommend you to die peacefully. Don't have too many people come around. Don't have all these people come and cry on your bedside. Yeah, that's not what you want. Have people who kind of are cheery and kind of they are, you know, come and they wish you well and they remind you of some of the nice things in your life. So you feel really happy afterwards. Get those people to come when you're dying. Yeah, those people who want to cry, you say, oh, okay, you can't be too harsh with people either when you die, but you know what I mean. There was a nun in Perth many years ago, before I got to Perth, apparently, and she sent a message to Ajahn Brahm, please come and see me, I'm dying of cancer in hospital. So Ajahn Brahm went to the hospital, and when he came to her door, there was a big sign on her door, it said, no visitors. Yeah, and then apparently at the very bottom of the notice, it said, except Ajahn Brahm, in small letters on the bottom. So basically, and she told Ajahn Brahm that I don't want people to come and see them because they're all crying and negative and think I don't have anything to do with them. But you can come because I know you'll just tell me a joke and then you'll leave me in better state of mind afterwards. So this is the right thing. Yeah? We don't need to cry when people aren't dying. We can just help to lift the spirits of the person and wish them a happy journey on into the future. And tell them, actually, the dying process is not that scary. Usually it's very uplifting. Here is a very positive experience. You're letting go of a body. When you die, usually your body is old, it's worn out, it's sick, it's had enough. It's actually nice to get out of this body when you die. It's a kind of a relief. Wow, so nice, get out of this body. Yeah, bye-bye body, enough, you know, send you off to be cremated or whatever, and then you can use the ashes in the garden. That's the most useful thing that this body can do now, or something like that. And then you have the right attitude. You even make some merit, yeah, by burning your body, give the ashes to the plants, or whatever. You make some merit as well at the very last moment in that way. Just keep on doing the right thing, and you will be, that's the best thing you can do now. Dear Ajahn, should a person meditate according to Goenka's method, if that type of meditation suits one better? What are the disadvantages of pursuing this method? Thank you. You can do the Goenka method if it works for you, if it gives good results, and if you feel that you're making progress on the path, and it's not too arduous, it doesn't cause too much pain and problems, you can do it. There's no reason why you can't do it. Do things based on what works. Yeah, this is the most important thing. If it works for you, no problem. The only thing that I would generally tend to argue is that, I always find it the most persuasive thing is to go back to the suttas. What does the Buddha recommend? He recommends mindfulness of breathing. So I would always come back to mindfulness of breathing. So maybe for a while you feel that the mindfulness of breathing is not working for you, so you focus on the feelings in the body. But if you make progress with that, always come back to the mindfulness of breathing later on. Do the metta for a while, because the metta is supportive for you in your meditation. Then come back to mindfulness of breathing down the track when your mind develops a little bit from where you are. Come back to the main things that the Buddha teaches in the suttas. And then I think you have the best possible chance for growing in the Dhamma. That's what I would recommend. So we don't need to be too dogmatic about things, that this is the only way, everything else is rubbish kind of thinking. That's also not right. It is, you have to kind of find the balance here somewhere. Okay. Is there some agency which analyzes, judges, selects, and allots the pratisandhi vijnana, relinking consciousness of the dead person to a particular birth? This cannot be a random process. If so, what is the agency and who is the judge? Is the agency which analyzes, judges, and selects and allots the relinking consciousness, the pratisandhi vijnana of a dead person? This is pretty automatic. Yeah, you can say that there is some degree of agency there, but it's largely very automatic. The idea of pratisandhi vijnana is not really very useful, because that is an idea which comes from the Abhidhamma literature, this idea that you have the Chuttichitta, which is the last mind moment of this life, and then the pratisandhi vijnana, which takes you straight to your next rebirth. That's kind of the idea. These are Abhidhamic concepts, and attempt to lead us a little bit astray because of that. But at least in this case they do, because they kind of leave out the intermediate existence. So when you have the intermediate existence, what happens is that, you reflect on your life, you feel whether you have lived well or not, and that is largely automatic. You can't really do so much about that, because you have done many bad things, you will feel bad about yourself. You've done many good things, you feel good about yourself. It's just the nature of things. That's what happens in this life, will happen also when you pass away. And that is the judging happening right there. You can't really avoid judging yourself to some extent. And then, because you judge yourself, you will feel what you deserve. You will feel, I deserve to be reborn as an ant, and you will be reborn as an ant. Or you feel, I deserve to be reborn in heaven as a deva, and then you will be reborn as a deva. So you will feel what you deserve, and it kind of happens almost by itself. Yeah, this is not something that you can really control too much. So it is just the nature of the mind, and you can see that process happening already in this life. Watch yourself, watch your mind, watch how you judge yourself on a regular basis, and you will know already what's going on. Okay, Venerable Sir, regarding the gentleman lady with the large appetite, okay, there was someone yesterday who couldn't stop eating. Bariatric surgery where the stomach capacity is reduced to a minimum, thereby inducing a feeling of satiety even after a small meal, is of proven statistically significant benefit and endorsed by several randomized controlled clinical trials. Okay, well, that's very scientific for you. I've heard, but that's actually quite common, especially some people who get really overweight and they have this band put around the stomach, intestines or the stomach in particular, and it reduced the capacity, yeah, and people breathe overweight, and within a few weeks they kind of have shrunk down drastically. Yeah, so that's probably what you're referring to here, I think. Yeah. If interested, suggest discussion with your GP requesting a referral to such a cutting edge center. Pardon the pun, the cutting edge center. Okay, thank you. Okay, good. So if you feel that you have too much appetite and you want to lose some weight, you want to eat less, I'm not sure whether that was the point or whether it simply was too much craving, but anyway, there you are. That is some extra information for you on that front. Okay, being peaceful is relaxing and pleasant in meditation, but can also feel a bit soporific and dreamlike. Can you give advice on how to maintain an alert, bright mind and gain clarity while maintaining a sense of peace? So soporific, for those who don't know, means sleep-inducing. Yeah, that's the soporific. So bright mind and gain clarity while maintaining a sense of peace. And the most important things, you know, for gaining clarity in the meditation is that you have sufficient mindfulness, of course. You have to have the mindfulness there. If you have a lot of mindfulness, you tend to have clarity at the same time. But also what is significant and important is to have that sense of something which is attractive in your meditation, something which is beautiful that you can watch, that attracts you. And in particular, the thing that the Buddha always talks about are the basic things of joy that can arise in the meditation practice. So if you can find that sense of joy, yeah, the sense of being grateful for being here, the sense of, this is a kind of rare opportunity to be here, feel all the burdens that you have left behind in your ordinary life. Think back to something in your life that really made you very happy, that something you did in your life when you felt very elated and happy because you did that. And these things are often things that can give you a little bit of joy. And that joy is enough to waken you up, brighten you up. The energy comes back, mindfulness comes back, and the joy is there. These three qualities, mindfulness, energy, and joy, very often go together in the suttas because they come together, they tend to arise together. So the energetic mind is joyful and bright. So the bright mind is energetic and joyful. The three usually come together. So try to find a little trick to access that joy and happiness. Yeah, well, you really want to be here because it's so marvelous to be present. That is kind of the critical thing. One of the ways of doing this as well is to try to do a bit of metta meditation. Yeah, metta meditation because it feels makes you feel good, makes you feel happy. So the same thing happens with metta meditation. I don't know if you like the death meditation. That also can make you peaceful in a fairly bright way sometimes. You can try that. Some people really enjoy that, some people not so much. So find a way to help yourself brighten up in this way. And if all of that fails, go outside, go for a walk, have a cup of tea, and then come back later on if everything else fails. Okay. Dear Ajahn, first of all, I would like to thank you for your metta and karuna. One question. So that's kind of the way to bribe me to get me to answer the question. Yeah, then I have to answer the question. Okay, fair enough. Buddhism talks a lot about happiness rather than contentment. Why? I'm wondering this because happiness, joy are more addictive than contentment. Thank you. Buddhism also talks quite a bit about contentment as well. You are right that happiness is more talked about. I think the reason is simply that even though it is more addictive, it is a necessary addiction to go forward on the path. You need to have that addiction to some extent because it is the happiness and joy that eventually leads to samadhi. Without the happiness and joy, you will not get to samadhi. That's the whole point. And this is what the whole process of dependent liberation is all about. Yeah, that process has to go via happiness and joy. And only then do you actually come to the samadhi. That samadhi becomes impossible. So this is why it is so important. And yes, it can be a bit addictive, but anything in life can be addictive. Whether it's addictive or not is not really not what decides whether it's important or not. What decides whether it's important or not is whether it is useful on the path. So this idea that, you know, we shouldn't do jhanas because you get addicted to samadhi, it's a crazy idea, because samadhi is part of the path, so we should do it. If it is addictive or not is a completely separate issue. What that means is that we should just be careful, but we should deal with it in the right possible way. But you can't avoid it if it's part of the path. If you get addicted to sila, you say, oh, I'm addicted to being kind, so I can't be kind anymore, you know? You can see how that kind of leads you astray very quickly if you think like that. So it is not, we have to do this thing simply because they are part of the path and they drive you in the right direction. So a little bit of addiction to that happiness, it's okay, yeah? As long as it doesn't stop you in your meditation practice. A little bit of addiction to being kind is wonderful, otherwise you're not going to keep your precepts purely. Little addiction to coming on meditation retreats is wonderful. Otherwise, we won't see you back again next year, or the year after, or next lifetime, or whatever it is. Making no promises, yeah, so see what happens. Dear Ajahn, in meditation, can I use a hot water bottle to alleviate back pain? Of course you can. Yeah, you can have many hot water bottles if you like. Yeah, use as many as you can. You can do whatever you want. Remember, it's about being comfortable. Yeah. So whatever makes you feel comfortable and relaxed, use that. And that is the way for you to go. There is no kind of, the Buddha doesn't say anywhere, hot bottle waters are against the vinaya. Okay. Okay, dear Ajahn, I do understand reality of anicca, which is impermanence, dukkha, which is suffering, and anatta, which is non-self. Do you need to practice other types of meditation, like decaying of the body, the watching, the rising and passing away of sensation of the body, etc.? Thank you. No, you do not need that. All you need to do is watch the breath. That will take you all the way to the end of the path. And I will show you exactly how that is and why that is when we get to the Anapanasati Sutta. Yeah, it's going to be exciting. So many questions are going to be answered when we get to the Anapanasati Sutta. I don't know how many times I've said this, so we really should set aside plenty of time for that sutta later on. Very dear Ajahn Ramani, okay. Number one, could you explain to us what does your name mean? Ajahn Brahm told us once the difference among Bhante, Ajahn, Venerable, and that sort of stuff, but never said anything about the monks' names. Okay, so what does my name, my specific name, what does that mean? Well, this is quite interesting. Ajahn Brahm, his full name is Brahma Vamsa, yeah? And Vamsa means like lineage or family. Yeah, you're part of the lineage. What lineage? Lineage of Brahma. Brahma's lineage. So in other words, it means you have the qualities of the Brahma Viharas, the qualities of Metta and Karuna, and those kind of things. Yeah, you're part of Brahma's lineage. And then Brahmali, yeah, that is Brahm, and then Muslim Ali on the end. Yeah? that's what I say to people. It's very easy to remember. Brahm and Ali, yeah. So, but no, it's got nothing to do with Islam. Ali, turns out, and I didn't know this when I chose this name, because in our monastery, you choose your own name. And then I said, yeah, I'm going to give you a name, find your own name. So, okay, you look up the books, you find a kind of suitable name. And it turns out Brahmali means exactly the same as Ajahn Brahm. It means like the lineage of Brahma. It's just another word for lineage, Ali. And I was quite shocked when I saw that. The cheapest, I have the same name as Ajahn Brahm. It's a lineage of Brahma, so I'm supposed to have little bit of metta anyway. That's kind of my ideals. I'm kind of trying to strive towards that, because to live up to my name, I suppose. So, okay, next one. Question number two. Are there any monasteries or meditation groups in Europe following the same tradition that is yours? Lots of thanks, Metta. Well, we have Metta Bhukchanda, yeah, we're sitting right here. She doesn't really have a monastery yet, but hopefully it won't be too long before she has a monastery, and she will. And you can go to her monastery, and you can ordain there, and will she get a nice, or he, or whatever it is, get a nice cutie?
I hope so,
okay. That's the plan, yeah, that's kind of the down the track, yeah. So, that is one possibility. There aren't that many. Ajahn Brahm has never really been very keen on having branch monasteries. He hasn't really been operating on that basis. But the problem is that we have so many people who want to ordain in a monastery in Perth that now Ajahn Brahm is getting desperate, so he's kind of building up little monasteries everywhere to kind of get rid of his monks, basically. So it's only a matter of time before I will get kicked out too. It's just, you know, this is probably going to happen soon, perhaps, not sure. Then, you know, you have to find a place somewhere. So keep your eyes open. These things are, you know, popping up in different places. But you don't have to go to an Ajahn Brahm monastery. There are other monasteries in the world, and sometimes they can be very good to go to as well. So it's really, you know, Paok Sayado in Burma is sometimes quite nice at the best. There are monasteries in Sri Lanka that are really nice. We have a number of monks from our monastery who live in Sri Lanka now. And often you get very secluded monasteries where you have your own little kuti, and all the nearest kuti is 10 kilometers away. Yeah, that's how far away you have your own little village for walking arms. This kind of stuff. You can almost only find that in Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka is one of the few places where you still have a very authentic way of living the monastic life. It's very, very, I've seen it with my own eyes, actually very beautiful and very nice. Very beautiful forests, very green, very lush, and very magnificent, actually, in Sri Lanka. I have, most of it, I have a very positive feeling about Sri Lanka. I think very likely I was a Sri Lankan monk in a past life. That's my guess. Try out different things, yeah? You never know what is suitable for yourself, and then you go with that. That's what I would recommend. Okay. Okay, dear Ajahn Brahmani, is it best to stick to one type of meditation than mix your meditations with other types, such as watching body sensations? My practice is the breath meditation, and I feel I need to master this first before I start watching body sensations and other types. Would I be correct in thinking this way, and what would Ajahn suggest? Thank you. You don't really have to watch body sensations at all. This is the Goenka technique. The Goenka starts off with doing a bit of breath, and you watch the sensations in the body. It is not necessary. And again, I will show you how the breath meditation is done from the beginning to the very end. And this is, again, going to happen in the Anapanasati Sutta. That the beautiful thing about Anapanasati is that it is one single meditation object that takes you from the very beginning when you start out all the way to the very end of the path. You can become an arahant, yeah, simply by watching the humble breath. Isn't that great? Just watch the breath and you become an arahant. Forget about all the sensations, forget about everything else. Just come back to the breath. This idea of watching body sensations is quite unique to the Goenka tradition. It doesn't say anywhere in the suttas that you have to watch body sensations. Yeah, it's just Goenka's method. I'm not saying it is wrong. If it works, fine, you can use it. But there's absolutely no reason to think that that is required for practicing the path. And that's why I say breath meditation is sufficient. Take you all the way. Keep it really simple. Understand the breath meditation well. Focus on one meditation subject really well, and if you know that well, then it will take you all the way there. But you don't have to use only one meditation subject. You can use a number. Sometimes it may be useful to do a bit of metta. Sometimes you do a bit of maranasati, which is the mindfulness of death. Yeah. Sometimes you can do other things, and you can also do the contemplation of the sensations in the body if you like it. That's also okay. So you can certainly have a variety, and depending on how you feel on a particular day, yeah, you can use different techniques. Or you can use one technique for a long period of time and then swap over after a certain amount of time because you find your mind has been purified sufficiently or whatever. So you can mix your meditation. You can also mix the meditations within one sitting. You can start off by doing a bit of metta just to kind of get yourself kind of get your mind sorted out a little bit, and then you can go over to the breath, or even vice versa. All of these things are possible, so you can experiment a little bit if you like. Dear Ajahn, do you think murderers and jihadists should also be met with metta rather than prison sentences?
P.S. I am making here a comparison with the bandits in the 2 days simile. You mean the simile of the two-handled sword, right? That's probably what you're talking about here. Okay, should they be met with metta rather than prison? It's not one or the other, it's both, yeah? Metta and prison sentence. Okay, sorry, you have to go to prison, yeah? It's not, these things are not mutually exclusive. Sometimes people have to go to prison because they've done something bad. It doesn't mean that you are harsh with them, yeah? It doesn't mean that you give up on them. You hope to be able to rehabilitate them. This is what, in my opinion, the prison sentence should all be about. It should be about rehabilitation of people, getting people back on the proper 2 days, thinking properly about what is best for them and society, making them proper citizens again. That is the best idea. The vast majority of people who go to prison, they are not criminals in any large sense. They happen to be caught because they made one or two bad acts. But most of them actually want to be upright citizens. And very often we send them to prison and make them worse people, because in prison you meet all the bandits and robbers or whatever, and you come out much worse than when you went in. What's the point of that? That's kind of madness, in my opinion. But if we can rehabilitate people, that is a wonderful thing to do, and they become upright citizens again. One of the things that I think Norway has, because I happen to know this because that's where I was born, Norway has been very good at is rehabilitating criminals. Very low rates of reoffending after people have gone to prison. Yeah, it's like something like under 30% or something like that, reoffending rate. And that's extremely low compared to the vast majority of countries in the world. And the reason is because the system is set up to rehabilitate people rather than to punish. The idea that we should punish people, I think, is silly. It doesn't make any sense. Why should we punish people? If they've done some bad karma, the karma will look after that anyway. Our job should be to try to understand, try to have compassion, try to make people into good citizens again. This is just my opinion, of course. That's what I think we should do. So have metta and have a prison sentence, and then look after them properly in prison so they come out again as better people afterwards. That's my kind of idea anyway. So, dear Ajahn Brahmali, you briefly mentioned that there is a difference between metta and karuna, and that karuna can be difficult and sometimes even dangerous, as you can take on the suffering of others. Can you expand on this? How can we protect ourselves from the suffering of others without becoming careless, not caring? Okay, it's just, you can feel this. Yeah? Sometimes, remember the purpose of the Brahma Viharas is to make the mind bright. Yeah, so does your mind become bright or not? Or does it become kind of dragged down by too much heavy thinking, too much heavy thoughts? Oh, there's so much suffering in the world. What is happening in your mind? And that is kind of the important thing. To see what happens when you do metta. See what happens when you do karuna practice. What is happening inside of you? And if it helps you to brighten up the mind, then you know you're heading in the right direction. If you feel it drags you down, you know it's going in the wrong direction. So it really depends on the on your ability to deal with these things in the right way. So think with that. But if you have any doubt, go to the metta, because I think the metta is generally a safer bet. Except if there is someone where you cannot see any good qualities, then you have no choice but to go to the karuna instead. Yeah, there's also an important difference between empathy and compassion. Yeah, and this is another paper that I read recently. It was also written by my friend Venerable Analayo, because he's into metta meditation and these things, and he studies quite a bit and writes for journals and all these kind of things. And he wrote an article about the distinction between empathy and compassion. And that is a very important distinction, because empathy usually means taking on the suffering of others. Empathize means if someone else feels bad, you kind of feel with them. Yeah, you feel the same feelings. And if you empathize too much, you get drained very, very quickly. Yeah, it doesn't take long before you feel completely depleted, because you basically feel like the other person. If they're depressed, you start to feel depressed as well. That's kind of useless in the long run. It can be useful in very small quantities just to kind of understand where they're at. But then you should actually stop pretty quickly, otherwise it's going to be detrimental for you. Compassion is the simple wish that may other beings be free of suffering. Yeah, it's that simple wish. You don't empathize with them necessarily at all, even, but you just have the feeling and the aspiration that others may be free of suffering. So you may help them, you may support them, yeah, but not necessarily empathize. That is the important distinction there. One is helping and wishing them happiness, and the other one is actually feeling what they feel. Oh, it's getting late. Okay, I'll do the last one for tonight. There's still a few left, but we're doing pretty well. So that's a good thing. Okay, dear Ajahn Ramali, my main meditation is based on the breath, but I have been told the problem with doing the breath meditation all the time, you can get attached to the happiness and not progress beyond the joy and happiness stage. Is that true, Ajahn? If that is the case, why did the Buddha teach the anapanasati? Exactly. That's a very good point, isn't it? Straight away, you know the answer right there for yourself. Did the Buddha teach other types of meditation in addition to anapana? Thank you. Right there, you have the answer. The Buddha says everywhere in the suttas, it is just absolutely everywhere, that joy and happiness should be developed on the path. This is what the very well-known dependent liberation sequence is all about. You have to go through pamuja, piti, pasaddi, sukha, all various stages of happiness before you get to samadhi. This is what the seven bhujangas, seven factors of awakening, are about. They have piti and pasaddi as factors of awakening. Yeah, this is what is in the Anapanasati Sutta. It's everywhere. Without joy and happiness, there is no way you're going to make progress in samadhi. You're going to stop very, very quickly. If anyone tells you that they get samadhi without joy and happiness, you know it is not the real deal. Yeah, it is some kind of pseudo-samadhi. So the point, again, is not whether you get attached or not. If you do get attached, you deal with that. The solution is not to avoid these things, because then you're not progressing on the path. The solution is to deal with the attachment if it happens. And the problem with attachment is that sometimes it can cause you not to be able to get to those states again. Yeah, if you get into a jhana state and then you crave for the jhana because you're attached to it, that may stop you from re-entering it. And that is really the problem. That is the problem with attachment. Attachment is not a problem in itself, but it's a problem because it stops you from making progress. So you learn to deal with it in the right way. That is the right attitude, not to not do it. There's nothing in the suttas that warns us against attachment to these things. Absolutely. Actually, there's one sutta which says precisely what I said now. This is in the Majjhima Nikaya. What is it? 100, I think it is in the 138 or something like that. Udesa Vibhanga Sutta. I can't remember now where exactly it is. But it says precisely this, that if you do attach to the happiness of the jhanas, it may hinder you from getting back in again. That is the problem. That's the only place it talks about the danger of attachment. And the danger is not that you shouldn't do it. The danger is it will stop you from going back in there, so you learn not to attach. That is the lesson from that. Yeah? So please, don't. When you hear these kind of things, be very skeptical, because this is really goes directly against what all the suttas teach. The idea that you should avoid the happiness on the path. If you do that, you will lose out on so much wonderful things. Yeah, this is kind of why the path is so beautiful, because it has so much happiness and joy and all those wonderful things. So please don't think like that, because it will impoverish your own life if you think in that way. Yeah. If we can't live rich external lives, which are useless anyway, let's at least have a rich inner life with joy and happiness and all these kind of things. Okay, that is all for tonight. So once again, have a nice night, have a nice rest, keep on enjoying yourself. We have another day and a half left, yeah? So don't think about the end yet. You're going to join us, and then we will use the time to the maximum benefit.